Hey guys, welcome to my channel Total Angrezi by Vidushi. Do subscribe to my channel, hit the bell icon to never miss an update, and do give me a thumbs up if you like the video. So today we are going to do the poem Animals written by Walt Whitman. We'll go through the entire poetry, I'll give you a stanza-wise summary, and we'll discuss some important questions. So let's begin. This is the first stanza. I think I could turn and live with animals. They are so placid and self-contained. So just as the title suggests, the poet has dedicated this entire poem to animals. I think I could turn and live with animals, which means to say that he wants to change into an animal. He wishes he could take the form of an animal and live with them because they are so placid and self-contained, meaning to say that they are so peaceful and self-contained in the sense they are happy within themselves. They are not greedy. They are not looking for more things that they can have or that they can afford. And that is why they are self-contained. They are happy within what they do. I stand and look at them long and long. The poet is so mesmerized by the way these animals conduct themselves, by the way they live, that he is standing there staring at them for a long time, hoping and wishing that either humans could live like animals or that he could be in that kingdom. They do not sweat and whine about their condition. So here again he is saying that they do not sweat. They do not sweat over here doesn't mean the actual sweat. Here they mean that they do not feel bad, or they do not cry, or they do not complain about their condition. They are happy with what we have, as opposed to human beings. Are we happy with what we have? If we've got 70%, then we're hoping to get 80%. If we have one jeans, we're hoping to have another color of jeans. If somebody has one car, they're hoping to get their next car, or maybe the house, or something or the other. Humans are never satisfied. Even with our friends, not just about possessions. If we have one thing, then we're looking forward to having a friend with another quality, and so on and so forth. But animals, on the other hand, are not like that. He goes on to say, they do not lie awake in the dark and weep for their sins. So, you know, when we are upset or when we have done something bad, we stay awake or we lose our sleep and we cry about it because we know that we have done something wrong. But animals don't do that because they are innocent beings. They are innocent living things. And so they do not cry about the mistakes they have done because they don't commit any mistakes. They do not make me sick discussing their duty to God. So the poet finds the fact that humans, even though they commit sins, they still boast about how they are dutiful towards God, how they do different kinds of things for God, how they try to make God happy. So this makes him sick because he says that it shows how humans are hypocrites. Hypocrites are people who say something but do something else. So he's saying that this attribute or this quality about human beings makes him very sick, that we say something and we do something. But that's not how animals live. Not one is dissatisfied, not one is demented with the mania of owning things. So he's saying that they are all very satisfied with what they have. They are not looking to add to their possessions. They are not demented. Demented is a mental illness, an excessive enthusiasm or desire, which is more or less like an obsession, like how we humans are always obsessed with having something or the other, comparing ourselves to others, that, you know, that kid got this, so even I have to have it. And adults are also like that, not just kids. We're all like that. We're never happy with what we have, and that is why these animals are much better than us, because they don't have the mania, they don't behave irrationally, they don't go out of the way, they don't get upset, they don't get anxious, they don't get overexcited or overwhelmed about any of these things, because they are just things, they are just possessions, and they are not greedy about having more than they should. Not one kneels to another, nor to his kind that lived thousands of years ago. So they're saying that they all believe in equality. Even though we humans believe in equality, there is not equality everywhere, and that is a known fact. No one kneels to another, nor to his kind dad. So in animals, that's not the way they live. They do not pray to one another. They do not bow down before one another. And neither do they have any ancestors, nor to his kind that lived thousands of years ago, means to their ancestors. They do not even pray to them. They have a very clean life with set duties to do, with set things to eat, and they just go on with their lives in that way. Their lives are not complicated as ours are. Not one is respectable or unhappy over the whole earth. So he's saying that it's not just one of them is respectable and the other are unhappy. It's not like that. But it happens so in human beings, right? Like the rich people are more respected. The poor people are not given as much respect. Or those who do not have everything stay very unhappy. So that's not how animals work. That's not how they survive. So they show their relations to me and I accept them. So he's saying that he's showing them that this is how they live and this is how they, what they show, they live accordingly. What he means to say is human beings are in the habit of showing off. They're in the habit of backbiting. They're in the habit of gossiping. But animals don't do that. Whatever they show, that is what they are. They are not aage kuch and piche something else. You know, they are what they show. They bring me tokens of myself, they evince them plainly in their possession. So here again he's trying to say that by tokens here, the poet means qualities. So he's saying that they have such kind of qualities, they evince them mainly in their possession and they're very happy. These qualities that they have, they are innate, they are naturally born with it. So they do not have to go and seek for other things outside because they're so happy with what they have on the inside. I wonder where they get those tokens. So now the poet is wondering, where do these animals get these qualities of being so happy, of not being gossipy, or of being so respectful, of being so innocent, of being so clear with their lives? Did I pass that way huge times ago and negligently drop them? So now he is again questioning, and this is a rhetorical question. What is a rhetorical question? Where somebody asks a very obvious question which nobody needs to answer. We all know the answer, and that's why they leave the question in the air without somebody actually answering it. So he's asking a rhetorical question. Did I pass that way huge times ago and negligently drop them? He's saying that, have I forgotten all of these qualities which even he was born with? Because everybody is born pure. It is on this earth that we become impure with our thoughts and needs and wants. So he's saying that, did I leave them somewhere behind when I was hoping to get something else? Or did I just drop them somewhere in the fight of being the best? So this is how he ends the poem, with a rhetoric question for all of us to wonder what we should do, how we can incorporate these tokens or qualities back into our lives, and how animals live a much fuller life than us human beings. Let's jump into the summary of this poem. Before that, once again, let me request you all to subscribe to this channel, Total Angrezi. You can also give it a thumbs up if this video helps you, and you can click on the bell icon if you want to continue receiving updates and notifications about the new videos. We're also present on social media handles like Facebook and Instagram, so you can follow us there too. So let's go into quick summary of all three stanzas. Animals is Walt Whitman's wish to enter the world of animals and enjoy their way of living. He wishes to exchange lives with them because he believes that they are more peaceful and happy within themselves. The animals are self-contained, meaning that they have no traits of interference and they keep their lives limited to themselves, unlike us human beings. You know, we human beings always want to know what is happening in our neighbor's house, what is happening in our friend's house, what would that person be doing. Animals are not like that. They don't poke their noses in others' business. They keep their life to themselves and they respect that line of boundary. But we human beings are much not like that. Animals are free from greed that makes the poet stare at them for long because he's imagining their life and sees how it gives them happiness, and what looking at them is giving the poet happiness because he's longing for that kind of a life. But we humans cannot have it because we're surrounded by other humans who are just like us. In the second stanza, as the poem progresses, the poet emphasizes on how animals do not stress about their lives. We humans stress about every small and big things. It could be as small as an invitation to a birthday party or the next exam or about what gift you would get. You know, small things. But animals are not like that. Humans sin almost every day and then they stay awake at night feeling guilty about their act. But animals are lucky because they don't sin, they are innocent, and so they can have a peaceful night's sleep which we do not take. If something happens to them, they do not cry all night. Neither do animals boast about their good deeds and express how they served God. But we don't do that. Even if we make a small donation, we go on telling around the world that this is what we did, and you know, see how we are serving God, and see how we go to the temple, and see how we sit and pray every day, and see how much I spend. Animals don't do that. Animals are happy and satisfied with what they have in their life. This is opposite of what humans do. They do not run behind achieving what they do not have, and they are not interested in possessions and worldly things. In the third stanza, unlike humans, animals do not devote their life to any of their ancestors, gods, or fellow animals. People, on the other hand, tend to do so in many ways. You know how we have many things, many faiths, many beliefs, many prayers, which is not wrong. But he's just comparing that to animals who do not devote their life to anybody else but themselves. There is no scope of comparisons as to who is more respectable and who is less. As we know, this is a constant fight in our society. Unfortunately, those with money or power, they're more respected than the rest. Another beautiful quality of the animals that is not present in humans is that they do not backstab anyone. They are honest with their relations with other animals. They know that they are meant to eat other animals, and they keep this very honest. They don't hide it. Humans try to backbite and they hide their true intentions many times, and this is just qualities of some human beings. Animals never show what they possess and what not. Their lives are very crystal clear. When the poet says token in the fourth stanza, he means qualities. Walt Whitman now wonders how these animals have attained these wonderful qualities, and then he introspects if he left these qualities behind as time went on, or did he lose them trying to achieve something else. He invested his time in achieving one of those worldly possessions so much that he lost all of these qualities. With qualities, the poet means innocence, kindness, respect, truthfulness, honesty, and all other such positive attributes which we all have. But then we couldn't keep them up in our lives, and that is why our lives are less peaceful than the animals. Let's run by the extra questions. You will find the answers to all of these questions in the summary and the line explanation that we just covered. In the first line of this poem, what does the poet mean when he says the word turn? It's there in the summary. Draw a comparison from the poem and mention three things that the animals have and humans don't. This is also a self-assessment answer. Draw a comparison. Maybe they're more respectable, they don't bow down before anybody else, and that they do not backstab. So these are my three qualities that I'm mentioning. You choose yours. According to you, do humans kneel before their ancestors? Oh, well, yes. According to me, they do. You have to tell us what you feel. What does the poet mean by the word tokens? We've covered this about twice, that it means the qualities that a human or an animal possesses. It seems like the poet adores animals. Why? You know, because he thinks that they live much peaceful, much fuller lives than the human beings. They do not have any negative qualities and are completely innocent, free of sins, free of any bad things that we humans sometimes tend to do. What kind of satisfaction do you think animals have and humans don't? That they are not greedy. They are not running behind worldly possessions. But humans don't do that, right? We always want something. That's how we all are. You, me, all of us. But animals are not like that, and that is why they are satisfied. What human attribute makes the poet sick? We discussed that. The fact that people first commit sins and then they show off about how God believing and how many activities they do to make their God happy. What do humans desire that animals don't? Again, the worldly possessions. Not one is respectable or unhappy over the whole earth. Explain this line. We've explained this line in the line explanation. Let's just go back to that. Here are the long answers. Why does the poet call human desires as mania? Do you agree with him? You know why he calls it mania. Because human beings are constantly on the run. We are obsessed with finding new things, with finding what we want, with fulfilling our desires, with achieving new heights, with buying new things. Do you agree with the poem? And if you do, you'll have to give reasons, because this is a lengthy answer. Mention those attributes that humans should have but don't have now. So pick out those attributes from this very poem, which according to the poet, humans don't have. why do humans not have it, and what happens throughout this entire poem. This sort of is kind of a summary of this poetry, this question. Why do you think that the poet feels that maybe we humans have lost their qualities? Explain your answer in detail. Now, this is something that you have to do by yourself. You have to think. Why do you think that the poet feels that humans have lost these qualities? According to me, we have lost it because we've become very self-involved. We're always striving for success. We're always trying to make our standards, our standard of living bigger and better. And in achieving all of that, we do not have time left to focus on the good things in our lives, and therefore we have started losing these qualities. But animals, on the other hand, are just how they were born years ago, centuries ago, and that is why they have those qualities and we don't. But here again, this is your perspective. If you agree with me, you can use this answer and back it up with a few more points. If not, come up with your own details. Thank you. We'll see you in the next video.